Good evening. Hello, hello. I'm trying to be close to on time. This program runs from 5:30 to 12:30. All right. First and foremost, thank you for taking time out of your long, busy day to join us, to have an idea about this visioning process. I've had the pleasure of being in another district where we've done this before. This is a very exciting time, and we couldn't pick a better group to do it. And so you guys are our honored guests, but you're also part of our vision and part of our process. Second, we couldn't be in this room without you. So from November till now, thank you for your patience, your commitment, your attitude, your excitement, and first of all, and lastly, your vote. Because it had to happen that way. There was a visioning process earlier today, and you're going to meet Dr. Locker soon. And one of the things that he said that made us very, very proud. We are always very, very focused on making sure that our children are part of our process, everything that we do. Everybody in this room, you're here because we love children. Correct?
Correct.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Somebody in the back was like, oh, I don't know about that son of mine. But that's why we're here. So we had a visioning process earlier today with children first, because that's our project. And they were absolutely amazing. So I'm hoping that with all the excitement that they brought to this morning, that the adults could be as exciting this evening. So I'm going to turn the mic over to Mr. Denny. Just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for everything that you do. Thank you for everything that you will do. And this is the most exciting time in Winton City Schools history. So welcome.
Thanks, Mr. Smith. And I wanted to just take a quick second and thank all of you for coming tonight. We really appreciate your partnership, your commitment to community, to education, to our kids. And we're very much looking forward to partnering with you and walking this forward for about the next, that's probably going to be about 4 years. So this is the first step in a long journey, but it's a great journey. And we're very excited to take it and take it with you. So I just wanted to briefly touch on that and also make sure that it's clear to folks that as we begin this process, this is the vision casting for our core business. Our core business is education. And we deliver a lot of other things, and we do a lot of other things. But our main function is to educate children and carry them to the next level and serve as a launching pad for them. So the educational vision work we started in 2012, what does education look like? And then secondly, how do we design facilities that help that vision thrive? That's really what our work is tonight. And that informs the design process, if that makes sense. So we want to make sure we have a firm grasp on what the building's intended to do, what these facilities are going to deliver, and that's how we then go about designing them. So I want to thank everyone for being here, and I will go ahead and pass it to Dr. Holden, actually. Terry Holden, there she comes. Surprise. Come on up, Dr. Holden.
Thank you, Mr. Denny. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I know many of you, so thank you for giving up your time tonight and being here. My task is to give you a little history, particularly about the academic piece of what's going to happen in these buildings. So right now I'm executive director of teaching and learning, but prior to that, for 6 years, I was principal of this very high school. So, in the fall of 2010, I was given a task by my boss at the time to work with a group of teachers, some of whom are here tonight, to create a school within a school that was innovative, had a global focus, but beyond that, there weren't really any parameters that, you know, supposedly should cost no money. So I asked for volunteers and got volunteers, and we met weekly, and in December had a plan for the board at the time to create the Academy of Global Studies. there were some very unique things about the Academy, or AGS as we tend to refer to it. It was based on foundations of two organizations, the International Study Schools Network and the New Tech Network. Students went a longer day. The instruction was provided through a project-based learning pedagogy. There was a focus on global studies. There was a focus on service, some other things like that. The board, after several meetings, the board approved. Kind of at the same time, we won an innovative schools grant through the state of Ohio. That allowed us to formally partner with the New Tech Network. So we did that, added grade 9 that first year, so 2011-12. Grade 10 the following year, so each year we added a grade level. So by 14-15, if my math is correct, we have our first graduating class of the Academy. So these children took their core courses in the Academy, but they were in band, and they were in orchestra, and PE, and health, and all of the art, all of the other electives. But what we found was, performance-wise, they outperformed all of the other high school students. Now, there were some gifted students in AGS, but there were also some students with disabilities, and there were also some English language learners, and there were also many what we would call your typical high school student. But on almost every measure, attendance, course grades, GPA, at that time OGT score, ACT score, they outperformed other students. But additionally, as principal, I saw something in these children that I thought, wow. And for me, that was most important. They were confident. They had presence. They could come into this very room with a moment's notice and speak to all of you and be articulate and appropriate and engaging. So those are the skills. As an educator, I'm like, this is what we've been needing for a very long time. So at that point, I was transitioning out to teaching and learning, and Mr. Martin came in, and he liked, obviously, what was going on here. He wanted that New Tech model for the rest of the high school. So for 1 year, we said, okay, we're going to try this. And then Mr. Smith said, as he does, he presses and presses, and he said, this is what's right for all kids. And it is. So New Tech said, hey, we have this relationship with you. The state of Ohio is offering straight A grants. We would like to partner with you to write this grant to really transform the district, right? Pre-K-12 into a New Tech district, a project-based learning environment. So in the fall of 15, November, December, we wrote the grant, submitted it, and I believe, I don't know, Mr. Smith, what was it, February 2nd, 2016, we were notified that we indeed did win a straight A grant. So for $911,700, I believe, to transform, it's a lot of money, we'll take it. So that grant is designed to transform the district. Here's why this is important, because these skills, these characteristics that I've seen in these students, some of whom are with you tonight, you will be able to tell. Even the middle school students who are here who've just been in this about 6 months, you're going to tell with them as well. This will allow all of your children, all students in the district, to get this type of experience. So when they start at our preschool and they go through each grade, by the time they get to the high school, the new secondary campus, we're not going to be able to stop these young folks. And they are going to change this district, and they're going to change this community, and they're going to change the world. I can promise you that. So, what is New Tech? The New Tech Network is a, what I would call a school transformation organization. It's part of a bigger group called the Deeper Learning Group. So their premise, New Tech's approach to it, is through project-based learning. We feel students, and this is the we as New Tech, and us as well, we feel students learn better when they're engaged and interested in what they do. So the primary teaching philosophy of New Tech is project-based learning, which means we still teach the standards, right? We're a school in Ohio, a public school in Ohio. We teach Ohio's learning standards. But the way we do that is through project-based learning. We tend to say wall-to-wall project-based learning, and that really is more secondary. So at the high school, for example, in every class, students receive their instruction through project-based learning. You know, you can change that model at the lower levels, but basically it's project-based learning. That's how we teach students. That's how they're going to learn. So what does that mean? What does project-based learning mean? It means that, for example, in science, we might teach some standards in biology. If we're teaching DNA or genetics, we're going to wrap all of that instruction in a thought-out, project-based unit so that students go through it and on their own, with the facilitation of the teacher, they learn the standards related to DNA or genetics or heredity or whatever the case may be. With New Tech as well, they focus on really four core pillars, and I think it's those pillars that really are what kind of shaped the behaviors that I saw in students in the Academy of Global Studies. Teaching that engages, right? You know, I'm of an age, and I'm looking out here, and I see many of you are of that age as well. We had a different type of instruction. That does not work today. Doesn't matter if we think it's right or wrong, it just is. It does not work today. So teaching that engages. Project-based learning engages students. My charge to you is to talk to these students and ask them. So that's the first pillar of New Tech. The second is culture that empowers. How do we teach youngsters, both first graders and 10th graders, how do we teach them to really feel part of their school environment, to feel like they have voice and choice in what happens to them when they're with us every day for 9 months during the year. That culture also extends to adults. How do we change the work with adults? The third New Tech pillar is technology that enables. So to do this project-based learning, New Tech thinks, okay, you have to have a one-to-one technology environment. Does that mean every student has a laptop? In the beginning, when we first entered in 2011, it didn't. There were some schools that had like labs. As long as they could measure one device per student, it worked. But things have progressed as technology does, so now we're one-to-one, actually Chromebook, district. So that's how students receive their instruction. There's a learning platform called Echo. I don't need to give you the details of that. But what that allows is for students to see all of their work in one place. It allows the teachers to house that work, communicate with students, and it allows parents to really have a window into everything that goes on in the classroom. So that's the third pillar. And then the fourth is outcomes that matter. Why do this if it doesn't produce the results that we want, right? You know, improved academic performance for our students, exposure to college and careers that they are interested in and that will be viable for them when they exit, so outcomes that matter. That's the you know, 30,000 foot view. There are a lot of details about project-based learning that really will become germane to these discussions. So, for example, if you have technology, right? Students are working in groups, very collaborative. How does that change the space that they need to do that work? If you are expecting students to use technology to take videos, interview others, how does that space need change? If you are expecting to deliver this project-based learning curriculum in a team teaching environment, in an integrated environment, as we do here at the high school, in those very nice looking modulars outside, how does that change? You know, do we need walls that retract or open up space and close space? These are all things that we'll think about and discuss that are important to the project-based learning process. One last thing, and then I'll just wrap this up, but with new tech, not only do students get an academic grade, right? We call that knowledge and thinking. And this is what's under the umbrella of a school-wide learning outcome. So knowledge and thinking. If I'm in Mr. Amstutz's Algebra 2 class, you know, my knowledge and thinking grade is how much Algebra 2 do I know? But also written communication. Can I write about math? Oral communication. When I'm in a group and I'm asked to get up and speak, can I do so articulately? Collaboration. In groups, do I work well with others, even those that I don't particularly care for or who may not be in my social group? And then agency. How self-disciplined am I? How motivated am I? What's my work ethic? Do I advocate for myself? So students are assessed on all of those. And that is what creates this picture of the students that I've described to you that exist right now in this high school, in our middle school, in our intermediate school. Actually, they exist in all of our buildings. They just don't know that they exist quite in that format yet. So that's a little history about how we got here and how the new tech network and project-based learning is going to shape our academics from here on out.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Carrie. Good evening. My name is Frank Locker. I'm an educational planner, and I flew in from Boston to be working with the students earlier today and with you tonight. I'm going to be the moderator for the rest of the evening. Let me do some other introductions, and then I'll tell you what the rest of the evening is going to look like. I have to say this. I've known about the New Tech Network since about 10 years now, when I was in Texas speaking, and I met a group of students from Capel High School who did a Q&A and just knocked me over. I said, I want that. So I became friends with them. I've been touting New Tech Network with all of the groups I do. I lead visioning all across the country, and I'm now working in a couple of other countries. And I share New Tech Network with everybody. Yeah, it's really true. Yeah. So to me, this is exciting. And when I heard that Winton Woods was moving to the New Tech model a couple years ago, I said, I hope they call me up and ask me to come and work with them. And guess what? Steve Denny made the call. So this is really exciting for me. Other introductions. First of all, Jeff Parker over here.
Good evening.
With our architects, SHP, largely responsible for the community survey that was launched a couple weeks ago. And then the stars of our show, students that we started working with this morning. Can you all stand up, please? We've populated them at the different tables. You can see, give them a round of applause. Yeah. So the work here, the banners on the walls, it's work that they did this morning. And we will, after the break, they're going to be much more visible and speaking about their work and engaging you to volley back and forth with them about their work. So that's generally the rest of the evening. Let me give it in a little more detail. So Jeff's going to come up and present the survey results. And while he's doing that, you have on your tables the sheet that gave you the magic number that asked you where to sit, told you where to sit. That's the one that you're going to use to track the responses that he's going to share. By the way, the reason we put you at, we gave you a number, was that we wanted each one of these think tank tables to have a balanced group of people. People that maybe don't see each other every day, people that represent different parts of the school community, et cetera. So that gives us our best and most balanced way of thinking. So, in any event, Jeff's going to present, you're going to respond, and then you will address a question. Of all those things, you're going to work at your table teams and come up with an understanding of all those things that Jeff's going to throw at you, which ones are the hardest ones to accomplish, and then what's it take to get it done. Then we're going to take a break, and we're going to share with you the results of some of the surveys, the top issues, and we're going to have the students share their work on those top issues, and then we're going to have you volley with them. And following that, we're going to wrap up with a really quick survey, which is basically this. What did I believe when I walked in the room tonight, and what do I believe now? Real quick survey. And then we'll get you out, hopefully, on time. But we will see you in a couple of weeks, because we've got another meeting scheduled on the 21st and another one on March 2nd. And at the end of the day, I'll tell you what those are going to be about. So that's the evening. Jeff, I'm going to pass it to you.
Great. Thank you, Frank. It's good to see you all. Frank flew in from Boston. I just arrived from the D section. You all know what that means, don't you? Yeah, I grew up here. I graduated from this building. I was a Charger then. I'm a Warrior now. But it's a real thrill to be working with you all in this capacity. I'm an architect. I'm also an educational facility planner, and that's why Frank and I are working together on this. And like I said, we're happy to be here. Now, I do have a little bit of housekeeping. All of you who have one of these numbers at your table and have two or more open seats at your table, would you raise your hand? Okay, keep them up for me, okay? Now, all of you in the back who do not have one of these on your table, would you come and find a seat with us? It's really going to help us later. Thank you very much. Keep your hands up, folks. Great. Perfect. All right. We've got another seat up here if we need one. Another seat here in the middle. Another seat here by the camera. Okay. Perfect. I think we can put our... Do we all know where we're going? All right. You can put your hands down. Thank you very much. Let's keep rolling. So, as Frank mentioned, we launched an online survey that we invited you guys to respond to. And I want to kind of walk through the logic behind that survey, as well as the results of that survey. You all have the little handout in front of you that has kind of the expanded version of each of these big ideas. So I don't want to laboriously read through them, but I'll kind of touch on the highlights, but you've got all the content there in front of you. So as we're going through, you know, tell us, do you think that the survey results reflect appropriately where we need to be or not? And you can offer comments on that sheet as well. Does that make sense? Okay, very good.
Yeah, let me just be more specific. So there's five tick boxes there. As he's speaking, oh, you've already done it. There you go. As he's speaking, just put an X or a check in the box, and then any quick notes, fast food notes. We're going to ask you to leave these on your tables as you leave. We're going to take all of them, correlate them. We're going to see what the pulse of the community is related to each specific issue, and we're going to pull all the comments and compile them. Mm-hmm. So it'll be an excellent record of what you're thinking tonight.
All right. Everyone clear? Okay, let's roll. Is it warm in here?
Yes.
I am dying. Man, oh man. Well, the sun's going down. That'll help. Okay, so that's why we need new buildings, right? Okay, so we asked basically two questions for each one. How are we doing today? That's what I've got represented here with the blue dot. And how do we want to be doing in 10 years? What do we aspire to in 10 years? Let me back up and say that the questions that we're going to get to, the first six, came out of the educational vision that occurred in 2012. Was anyone a part of that group? Raise your hand. So some of you were. Okay. So that was a really good product, and we didn't think that we needed to reinvent the wheel on this. So that's where these ideas come from. That's their origin. The four after these six are the new tech pillars that Dr. Holden spoke of earlier. Okay. So we really want to measure the difference between where we are today and where we need to be in 10 years. And based on the scale of that difference, or the magnitude of that delta, we will be able to identify the priorities that we need to specifically tune the building to support, right? If we're achieving pretty closely, that means we're getting it done pretty well right now. We can do better, but we're getting it done pretty well right now. The ones that we're struggling with, likely there's a building component that we can put in place to support that. Okay? All right. So principle one, all students will show academic excellence. So today, we're a 4.3. That's what the survey said. And in 10 years, we want to be a 6.5. So we're doing pretty well today, a little above average, a little above neutral. But we really want to be pushing hard to make that sing, to really make that work. One thing that you'll notice in the comments on there is that it says that our students will achieve higher than our neighboring districts. We're not just going to meet the standard. We're going to excel. I think that's a really telling comment in this. Principle two, global citizens. Started out at a 4.8, and again, you can see we have some ground to cover here at a 6.7. Let me flip to my notes. Yeah, the big comment or the big takeaway for this one in my mind is in the last sentence of that description. It talks about thriving in this ever-changing world. When I was coming up, the world changed maybe every 25 years, right? But now it seems like the world changes every 25 seconds or so. So how do we train up an individual who is capable of evolving at that quickly, at that quicker rate? How do we teach someone to adapt and adjust to realities that are changing all the time? Guiding principle number three, community connections. The students and I, and Frank and I talked about this morning. Some of what came out of that and some of what you'll read in the comments there is the students' connection to their community, the Winton Woods community, and to the world. And vice versa, the world's connection to those students and the community's connection to those students. It's a two-way thing that we're trying to foster here. Okay? Yes.
Point of clarification. So the blue, those are results from 2016, 2017, or from 2012?
Just over the last few weeks, the group was invited to respond to the survey. So the blue represents the current response as of this month, as of this week, actually. And the green is where we desire to be, where we think is an appropriate destination for us in 10 years. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Any other questions while we're...
Okay, let me grab this for a second. So just quick housekeeping. The question you are asked for each one of these is this. This is the quick summary of the research from the last couple of weeks. This is where people said the schools are now, and this is how far they want to aspire. And the question is, does that feel right to you? And so how much do you agree with that? You might think, for example, on a particular issue, we don't really have to improve over being in the middle. Mm-hmm. And if so, your answer would be different than somebody else who would think that we really should be even further over to the end. So you're actually being asked to respond to whether this research data feels right to you. Does it feel as though this represents your understanding of the schools and your sense of the whole community? Mm-hmm. Okay, very personal question.
Great. Guiding principle number four, celebrating diversity. As you can see, we're doing pretty well at this right now, 5.2, which is a great thing. But you can see we still aspire to do better. I think, are there 27 languages spoken here now? That's impressive. That's a good thing. Creative expression. The arts is a big part of the culture and the fabric of Winton Woods. Performing arts, creative arts, but also there's a hands-on component to this that you'll read in there. And that all, not only it's not an end in itself. It creates better learners and better well-rounded individuals. That's why this is a priority. So we're at 5.3, stretching to a 6.7 there. So a couple smaller deltas here. And the last one regarding the guiding principles, monitoring, assessment, and accountability. How are we doing? Are we really delivering on what we're saying? Are the kids learning? Are they excelling? Right now we're at a 4.2. We desire to be at a 6.4. Okay. As you read through that description, it talks about kind of an interactive monitoring process, which is a very individualized thing. It's not taking the test and scrolling out the percentages and moving to the next subject, but it's actually meeting with your facilitator, with your teacher, determining the best course forward to help you achieve what you need to achieve. Okay? So those are the six guiding principles. Now we're going to move on to, this is kind of where they stack up. And you can begin to see there's kind of a cluster here of two and above. The academic excellence, community connections, and monitoring, assessment, and accountability. Right? We had the students work on those this morning to help us understand what those look like, and we're gonna let you hear a little more about what they thought later in the evening. Okay, the next group is the new tech pillars. The first one is teaching that engages. These are really pretty self-explanatory. So I'll pick up the pace here.
Do you have a question here?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, could you?
I'm just clarifying, we're supposed to be saying on our survey whether we agree with these results.
Yes.
And then because the results are two-part, I mean, there's the first number and the second number. What if you agree with one number but not the other number? you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I would ask you to kind of respond to the big picture, the delta. Let me back up to this. If this feels right, we've got a lot of ground to cover on academic excellence. You agree with that? I would ask you to kind of respond to that. Frank, does that make sense?
Yeah, and I think you could even generalize it. For example, creative expression, you might think that that's not important at all, and you would strongly disagree with everything on there. And then your notes about it would reinforce that. Is that okay? Yeah?
Okay.
That was just an example, by the way. Yep. I'm not telling you how to vote. Oh, they are teachers over here. Just
more
an
questions?
Example.
More questions? Okay. I hate standing back here, but I think it's the only place I can be where everyone can see. So I apologize, but I'm going to stand here. Teaching that engages. Currently, we're a 4.3. We aspire to a 6.7. That's a pretty significant delta there, right? We heard a lot about engagement this morning from the students. A culture that empowers. Giving students and teachers and administrators the flexibility and the leeway to do things a little differently sometimes, to try something. That's a little scary sometimes. A 2.2 delta on that, difference on that. Outcomes that matter. Okay. In my mind, this has a lot about, you know, as I mentioned, the kids talked a lot this morning about projects that are engaging, that are interesting to them. Outcomes that matter are things that have kind of a real world impact. Okay, they're not abstract ideas, they're not, but you know, they really mean something somewhere. So a 4.2 and a 6.7, that's a big stretch on that one. And finally, technology that enables. Dr. Holden talked a little bit about the Chromebooks and the Echo software, that the Echo interface, and how that is incorporated into learning. So a 2-point delta on this. So that's where we landed. On these, we'd like you to focus on the top two. We're going to kind of build our conversation for the remainder of the evening around those top two. Teaching that engages, and outcomes that matter. And this is both groups together, so you can kind of see where they stacked up.
We're leaving this slide up, right?
Yes, we are leaving this slide up, Frank. Mm-hmm. Actually, we'll leave this one up. So those are the top five.
Okay.
Is that comfortable with that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So.
You ready to pass this on to them?
Take it.
Oh, I've got my own mic.
Yes, awesome.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Okay, so you've heard the big outline. We've got students planted at a number of the tables, so if you're lucky enough to have a student, you can get some questions from an expert. And we've got one question for you, and this is a group discussion. And I've, by the way, got paper here that we forgot to put on your tables to help taking notes on this group discussion. So this is tables discussion. Each table is going to address the same question. And it is simply this. For all of these things that Jeff just outlined, which are asking for various degrees of change, but all somewhat in the same range, the question for your table is, which one of these is the most difficult to accomplish, and how would you go about doing it? So what advice do you have? You know kids, you have kids, you know the schools. Help us focus on accomplishing this stuff. And so it's now 15:15. If you could work on this at your tables we're not going to give you much time. Say 10 minutes, hit the big ones, and then I'll call on some spokespeople who want to share ideas. Yes, sir. The questions are, which one of these is the most difficult to accomplish, and how would you go about doing it? What do you suggest for the schools to go about doing it? The biggest task and your approach to the task. All right? I'll bring paper around to the table so you have something to take some notes on. So we have a couple of minutes here. What I'd like to do is have volunteers stand up and outline what their thoughts were on any of these issues. Which one's the hardest to accomplish, and how would you go about doing it? I've got a spot to take some notes to be sure we record at least the issue that you're going to hit. So, there you go. All right, hang on. You need a microphone.
No, I'm not sure she needs a microphone. Here.
Thank you, Jeff. My table, we're very diverse, and I was a part of the class, the first one that talked about going into this new school. We're looking at academic excellence as being one of the biggest things for us to achieve, which is hard. Why? Because you have turnover. turnover. You have different cultures here. And then not only that, we don't really focus on the kids like we should. We give them what we think they need, but the question is, what questions are we asking the youth? What are we giving them? And some of the things that we looked at are what makes sense in the neighborhood, what makes sense with your community connections, how do you respond? I'm actually working with one of the young people here at the school. It's because he's from Argentina. His issue is no one talks to him. He doesn't know his community. So my question is, are we really engaged? Are we really speaking to the academic and excellence? We have so much of competition, but the question is, what is the real competition that we're actually facing? Is it the other schools? Is it the private schools? Is it the charter schools? And the question I have for Wade Woods, what are we doing as a family and a community to bridge that gap? And that's what we focus on our table.
That's great.
By the way, my name is Kathy Gray.
Kathy, thank you.
Table 11.
Kathy, you've set an impossible standard, but let's just see what happens next. I've got the mic over here. If I can... Jeff,
can you
I'm
get
closer
to
him. Here you go, sir.
I'll stay on this side.
Okay.
We're Table 14. My name is Stephen Easley. We, too, had focused on academic excellence, but then we also looked at community connections. And we said the difficulty with community connections is the demographic of the Winton School District is very diverse. So a lot of the people are not connected just by inherently. They don't have a connection with the school. They don't have kids that are still in the school system. Their kids have probably come here at the early ages and then matriculated out to other schools, so they don't have that connection to find out what's going on with the learning process here. And then we have so many demographics and backgrounds represented in the school that the language barriers may be difficulties to communicate with. So we thought that was a huge issue to try to overcome, but ways that we can overcome that is by first, letting the community know what's here. There's a lot of talent here in the school that can be showcased. There's a lot of learning programs that are taking place here that aren't taking place in other areas, such as the new tech learning. So helping them to understand the benefits of that, helping them to understand how it helps to excel not just their students here at school, but also at the next level when they go on to college or whatever trades they may pick up, because you're not just learning about academics, you're learning life skills. You're learning ways, social skills, you're learning how to interact and work with each other, which all of us here do, no matter what job you have, it's probably a good thing that you're not doing it just by yourself. There's probably someone else that you rely on to complete your task. So the students are learning that firsthand here. So I think one of the difficulties we're gonna have is ways to communicate that to a community that isn't engaged. If they're not showing up, they're not hearing and seeing these things firsthand. So we have to take it through those of you that are showing up to share that message with your friends, your neighbors, your family members, to explain what is happening here and what can happen here if we all get engaged. So that was what our team looked at and thought was important, and that's what we would like to share.
Great.
So a very conscious community outreach effort that relies on people relying on people.
Absolutely.
Yep, okay. Anybody else want to share? Oh, you got it, Josh. Yeah, for it.
Josh Homstutz. We also focus on community connections. Table seven. We focus on community connections as well. We had a different kind of take on it. We thought, going back down to the elementary levels, that our students do really, really well with accepting those with disabilities. And that's taught at an elementary level. We have a middle school teacher here who said that it's happened at the middle school, and I see it at the high school. And we think that that's because we incorporated that into the bubble that is known as Winton Woods City Schools. So in order to incorporate the community at large into our bubble, to help it be incorporated more into the school, just like we incorporate those with disabilities, we need to have some type of shared community space, meaning that our new building should be open to the community, not 24/7 per se, but from the morning until 9 or 10 at night. Maybe instead of having to go to Latino Ministries, we have Latino Ministries come here. We have a session here where we can help those learn English, and then we can have our students help to tutor their kids or watch their kids while they attend those classes. We see that as a great way to get community service, to help showcase what we do, but also to help our community at large.
Awesome.
Okay. And Josh, I was going to ask you for an example, but I think we got it.
Great.
Yeah, great.
Cheers.
Okay. Right here. Oh.
My name is Alondra. Our table is number 10. And what we talked about was outcomes that matter. And this was important because how do we decide the key to success is communication. This is important because you can't really get anywhere. You have to communicate to...
Take your time, baby. It's okay.
We have to communicate to decide, like, how we're going to do something. And so students have to... Okay. Students should have a say in what we're doing, like teachers, and it's kind of hard to fit what students want and what teachers want, because sometimes that won't go together, because what students want sometimes isn't the best for what teachers have to, like, meet for the state standards.
Great.
Woo. Yeah.
Right behind you, hon.
So let me just pick up on that, because this is really important. The national term that is emerging to express that concept of student participation is student voice. And tradition of school is that the teacher has the biggest voice. We know that that disengages kids, because the teacher can't really attend to every single kid in the room equally well at the same time. So your idea is to have students, give them voice, have them participate, be a partner in crafting projects and reviewing projects, et cetera. Is that yeah? Okay, and what we know from research is that learning goes up when students have a voice. Okay, anybody else? We got a minute or two? Oh, here we are.
Wait. Can we go here?
Oh, I'm sorry, he's standing up already.
Very well, stand up.
And in the interest of time,
the table might
Steve,
go
you go. Is it Steve?
John.
All right, John. I believe you. Okay, you go, and then you go, and then we're going to take a break, okay? Go, John.
That's okay, thanks. All right. So this table thought very strongly that academic excellence was the most difficult thing to accomplish. Some of the ways that they felt that they needed things that needed to be done in order to accomplish that. There needs to be support, mutual support, and communication between parents, students, and the school. They felt that there had to be a partnership with the parents, the family, or the parents and students, again, in the school. So it was a very strong feeling that the communication between school and family was essential in accomplishing these goals. That parents also need to feel valued. In other words, their input is valuable, and sometimes they felt that it was not listened to. And each party has responsibilities, and that would be, again, the parents, the students, and the school. And this group thought that those not only need to be communicated, be written down so that everyone clearly understood what their responsibilities were. And the bottom line was that over here they felt strongly about the state report card and how were we doing on the state report card, and how was project-based learning, new tech network going to help us accomplish that goal, which again was academic excellence. Thank you.
Okay, so another form of outreach, and do better at connecting to the parents. Okay, over here there was one more, and you're the last one, and I'm going to hand you the mic.
Hi, I'm Andrea. We're at table number 9. So what we thought the strength was teaching that engages. And the challenges are academic excellence and outcomes that matter. The strengths are PBL teaching. Project-based learning teaching. Students are to be well-rounded. And some struggles are parental involvement. Motivation at home. What motivates them to want to do their work once they get home? Transit population. Okay, I understand that. A lot of kids are coming in and out of school. And, you know, they may be here for a while or gone, or they may be new, such as the young man they talked about from Argentina that Kathy brought up. You know, what are we doing to make them feel welcome, involving them, engaging them in the community and in the school? And I see that the schools have come so far since my boys came here for school. That's it.
Oh, here it is. Thank you. All right, so how are we embracing new students? How are we getting them into the swing of things and making them a part? And that's all intentional work. Okay, good stuff. We haven't heard from a lot of you, so I would again comment that you, if you could put your table number on any notes that you have, be sure that they are on the table so we can scoop them up later. Right now, we're gonna take a 10-minute break. And so we'll come back, and you'll get to see our star students, and you're gonna dialogue with them.
Students, if you were one of our four presenters tonight, would you come up?
Represent now.
Yeah, let's give him a hand. Come on up. There's one more. Yeah. And Alyssa, very good.
Should we introduce them?
Yeah.
So we're going to do a lot of mic passing back and forth. Let's just welcome up to the stage here. Just say your name and what grade you're in and then pass it on.
My name is Charles Brown and I'm in 11th grade.
I'm Kenny Greer and I'm also in the 11th grade.
I'm Evan. I'm a freshman.
I'm Alyssa Lauren.
Good job, Alyssa.
I'm Alyssa Lauren and I'm in 12th grade.
I'm Alondra, and I'm in 8th grade.
Okay.
Great.
Welcome.
Yes, thank you. Am I? I lost it.
Did I do something?
There, I'm back. Okay. Great. So we essentially had the same conversation this morning that we've been having with you all tonight. And we asked the students, essentially, what has to be done to make these things happen? Or asked differently, and the way we phrased it was, if we're serious about doing this, what's it gonna look like, right? So we assigned an idea to each of our five groups and we had them kind of boil it down to some big ideas. So let's see, who had this first one, academic excellence? Who's that? Oh, okay, here we go.
So for academic excellence, a couple of things that we talked about and what you would see in 10 years if we did accomplish this goal would be caring about the learning and success of the students. Not only teachers and administrators caring about the learning and the success, but also students caring about the learning and success that they are gaining from the school and the teachers. Student accountability and responsibility, or what we know as agency. So being our self-discipline, the firing process that we go through if you're not holding up to your part for a project, time management, the benchmarks or the homework. Not all homework is assigned by teachers. If you're in a group and you're not up to par or whatever with your group by the end of the day, then maybe your team leader is going to say, hey guys, let's get this knocked out for homework. Let's keep it moving so we're on the right track. The work will demonstrate students' best abilities. So if you're doing a project, the end result of that project is going to be the best work you were able to pull off from that project. Not only are you giving it, okay, this is what I did for the project, but this was the best I could do because of what the teacher taught me or what I gained from the project rollout and all the benchmarks that we went through. Teacher-student cooperation and collaboration, or we share the same goals. So sometimes when we do project rollout, maybe the students are saying, well, this is my goal for the end of the project. That might be the same goal as the teacher's, but the student shares the same goal, so they said it first. Now the teacher says, oh, Good idea. It was my goal first, but I'm not going to tell you that because I'm going to let you have your shine. So it's the thought that maybe, the students really do have the same goal. They just, it takes them longer to realize, oh, that's where I want to be. And then we also have learning is visible and evident. So the learning that we're gaining from the classroom, it's visible if a community member is to walk in the classroom, if a student's talking to them, they can definitely look and say, hey, I understand what you're doing because you're doing such a good job at understanding it and putting it into your project or putting it into your presentation. Not only do the staff members who are rolling out the project or the students who are doing the project, they're not the only ones who understand it now. It's visible to everybody that views the project. The effective and frequent communication. So communication is key for project-based learning. If you don't have good communication skills, you're probably going to struggle a little bit. But don't worry, we'll iron it out and everybody's communication will be up to par.
Thank you, Kenny. Yeah.
Hey, Kenny.
What a great start. Let me just step in here and do some housekeeping. So Kenny was addressing the question of academic excellence. Which tables have that as your, okay, you do? Academic excellence over here, you have it? Academic excellence over here, anybody else? Oh, over in here, okay. So you heard Kenny. When you get your turn, which will be after these presentations, your first question is, well, do we agree with what he said or what the other ones say? And then how do, what's that?
No, I'm, yes.
Okay. So the first question was, well, do we agree with the students? And then the second one is, you know, what does it have to be done to make this work?
Right. So,
we'll run with the student presenters.
We're gonna keep running. Kenny said a word that I don't often hear students use.
Collaboration.
No.
What? Accountability.
Agency. Kenny, can you tell us a little more about that?
Okay, so agency is one of the things that we also get graded on here when we do our projects. You have several categories. I'm not even going to try to name them all because I can't do it. But agency is one of the main ones. Agency falls under the category of if you're doing your work on time or if you have great time management. Also, homework. That's agency. So keeping yourself accountable to what you're doing, not the teacher is saying, okay, this is due. If you don't do it, then you didn't do it and you're not going to get the grade for it. It's you saying, okay, this is due now. I need to get this done. Or setting goals within yourself. It's self-discipline. Okay, that's due on Thursday, but I have the power of myself to get it done by Tuesday so I can move on and be ahead of the game in case something that comes along further along will hold me back. It won't hold me back because I'll be ahead of the game. So agency is really that time management piece and that self-discipline to really get you pushing yourself and taking control of your own projects.
Wow.
Right.
Good work. All right. So the next one is community connections. Who had that? Come on up, Alyssa.
I didn't know it was going to be on camera. Hi.
Here. Should I do this?
Community connection. This is a big topic that me and my group have was discussing at our table over there. What are we 18?
16.
Yeah, we're table 16. So one of the persons we're talking about was community connection involves with people coming into events that we have in school. I wouldn't say that we're tired of seeing the same faces, but it's hard to, you know, get new people coming into our events or supporting our students. So that's something that we would want to, like, make what stronger, I guess. And then earlier, my group and I, this morning, we were talking about community connections through having fairs and events and having, like, the community involved. For example, I know that schools in Madeira, they have fairs and events to help the community with high schools. And I think that's really interesting. I think Winwoods could do that, definitely. But a huge problem with that would probably be money-wise. So fundraiser would be a good idea as well. And I think right now, for community-wise, we're doing a good job, especially with mentors for freshmen. We have mentors who come in and speaks with them, and they let them ask questions. They answer, you know, what's your job like? What's the real world? What am I expecting? So I feel like we've done pretty good and well with community connections, and I think we're on our way there. So I think else I need to say. Oh, and recycling. recycling, guys. So we're getting to recycling. We actually have recycling bins here at the high school, but I think that we could really get more engaged into it. And like with planting trees outside, definitely, we can make the high school look really beautiful if we have big trees, beautiful plants, and make it look like it's really appealing. And possibly have more people come and visit the high school and look at what we've been doing for New Tech and AGS.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Alyssa. All right. Oh, this is, we had a little goof up this morning. We had some technical trouble, so we completely missed this one. We asked the question the wrong way, so we're not going to present it tonight. We'll ask the questions to address it later on in a subsequent session. So we're going to move on to the next one. New Tech Pillar, Teaching That Engages. Who has that? Ready?
Jeff, can you slide over so they can see the words?
Thank you. So, tell them who you are.
Okay, so I'm Charles Brown, like I said before.
Hold that for Charles.
I'm Evan. Okay, so for Teaching That Engages, one of the points that we wanted to hit on was collaborative hands-on. I don't even need this mic. Was collaborative hands-on.
You need the mic.
I don't like
Sorry, Charles.
It's collaborative hands-on projects that have real-world relevance. So we have a class called Precalculine Physics taught by Mr. Josh Armstrutz and the wonderful Mr. Bradney Semino-Wazalewski right here. And we were recently doing a unit on waves, and we did a collaborative hands-on project about for the Intergovernmental Oceanic Commission. And it had a real-world relevance because we were actually solving a problem that they have, what happens when two waves collide with each other. So I feel like it engaged us that we were talking about something and learning about something, fixing a problem that people actually like struggle with like in the world. So I feel like that helped with that. Also, with collaborative hands-on projects, we are working in tandem with our teachers. Like I have two sisters that are a grade above me, and I have some of the classes that they had last year, and I'll come home and I'll tell them what project we're doing, and they'll be like, I hated that project because of this. And I'll be like, well, that's not part of the project anymore because the teacher fixed it because of what the students said about it. So I just like that a lot, and I feel like that's really effective that we're able to work with our teachers like that to create something that we both care about. Also, we have broader project options and choice. We get a pretty wide range of what we want to study. Like for the wave project, we got to pick what the length of our wave was, what the speed of it, all the stats of the wave, basically. So we got to pick something that we liked. So it helps with them getting the content pushed out and getting us to know everything that they need us to know for the test. And it helps us with wanting to know the information because it's stuff that we picked out, something that we created, that we're going to be proud to say that we created at the end of the project when we do the culmination of the presentation, whatever kind of final product that we're producing. And that also goes with reflecting student interest because we're creating something that we want to create. And then for more challenging and higher expectations, I had somebody come in and ask me questions about the catapult project we were doing a couple months ago and how he was talking about when he went to high school, he did math and he was really good at it. But then when he stepped into college and into his job and into his profession, it was a lot harder because he actually had to apply it to something. So I feel like that's a lot more challenging because not only are we learning the concept and how to perform algebra on a piece of paper, but we're also learning how to apply that math into the real world and how we're going to be able to use it in like a later time and how it's going to matter to us outside of high school because, I mean, that seems to be the main focus is to prepare us for the real world and prepare us for college and what we're going to do after college. So I feel like that helps a lot because we're going to be able to do something with the information rather than just knowing it. And we have teaming space for teachers to collaborate and learn from each other. I feel like this is one of the most important things because sometimes I feel like there are teachers that want to feel like their class is the whole school. They want to give us 3 hours of homework each night. They think their class is the only project that matters. And them being able to team up together and collaborate to learn that every class should have equal representation, especially when we sometimes have projects that correlate with one another. Projects that are going to, we're going to be talking about English-related things in a math class, stuff that we're going to be like talking about some of the same things, not the same like content, but we're going to be relating it to the same culminating project that we're doing. And the last thing was a broad range of tools in which to complete projects. One of the broad range of tools that we have with all of us having computers is the internet, which is, can we have a round of applause for the internet? The internet is one of the best things to ever be invented. And with the internet, we can just know so much information so quickly.
Google knows everything.
Also, another broad range of tools, like we have tools to complete project with, like, I know I keep referencing the pre-calculus physics course, but we had to build a catapult. And we had all the tools we needed to do that. We got wood, we had wood things to cut the wood, we had like hand drills, even though like I cut my finger on it. We had hand drills, like. Okay, Evan wants to talk about something now.
So I just want to talk about why this thing is probably the most important to me. In a classroom, you want to learn a lot more and you want to interact a lot more with the teacher, and you actually care about your grade when you're doing a project, and the final outcome of the project is not a grade, rather a tangible thing you could hold in your hands. Like right now in my physical science class, we're learning about Newton's third laws, right? So we're building rockets out of 2-liter bottles and cardboard, and we're gonna launch these rockets outside sometime once we're done building them, and we're about to see how Newton's third laws apply. So not only are we learning these things in these classes, but we're applying them to real-world scenarios, which is actually really important, because I've heard of people who went on to college and they were not prepared at all in their high school about real-world things and how to communicate with other people, how to relate their learning to real-life things, and they did not succeed. So I think that's why they enforce it so much at our school, especially with the NTA and AGS, because it's really important. And when you're learning about something and you're making things with your hands rather than just writing down equations on a paper or writing a poem, the students actually care about what they're doing, you know what I mean? They get more engaged, they get more interaction, and that's something that effective teachers do. So, like I said, this is probably one of the most important things to me, and overall, it just helps out everything else on this list if we have effective teachers. So it's kind of like the foundation for all this.
All right.
That's it.
My name is Alondra Sotelo, and my topic was outcome that matters. And the big question is, to whom? Students, teachers, parents, and whose outcome are we expected to fulfill? Like, and it's very important to think about, who are we talking about? Students? Is it students that we're talking about? And how do we know it was a great outcome overall after? Because we won't know. And the state standards, how would we be able to tie this in and still have our say in it and still reflect off of our student interest? Solving real problems is very important because, I mean, we're living in the real world, so we kind of should tie in what we're living outside of school with our school work. That's okay. Good.
All right.
Thank you all, great job. I think you can have a seat. Any questions for these scholars up here? Nice job,
yeah.
Thorough.
Great job.
So one thing I wanted to point out on this last one, though.
more challenging, higher expectations. That came from a group of sixth graders today. They want to be challenged more. They want people to expect and demand more of them. I thought that was a great comment. I just wanted to reinforce that. So, Frank?
Okay, so you heard from the students. Each table has its assignment. And the question for your table is, what has to be done to make this happen? Or if we really believed in this, what would it look like? Jeff, can we toggle back and forth through these four or five different examples so that it'll come around and they can be queued up? And it's now on the official clock on the wall. It's almost 10 after. And we are going to do this challenge until 7:45. So at about 8:30, I'll call the room to order and we'll hear spokespeople identify, share okay. your table concepts. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. All right, folks. Let's see what you're thinking. So I've got the issues on the screen right now. We've got a lot of buzz, so that sounds really good. And most of the table teams have been using the big flip charts. The good thing about that is that it'll make your thinking visible. Just as we know that making learning visible helps everybody, making thinking visible helps everybody. So what I would like to do is we'll run down the sequence and have spokesperson from the various teams share their ideas. So let's hit the first one, academic excellence. Which teams, which tape? Yes, sir. You ready to go? So you've got one. Let's start with you guys. Poster child, where are you?
Liz can be the poster child. She'll hold it up for me.
Yeah, but she's still writing it.
No, she's writing and bringing it up.
Okay. So academic excellence, we've made a little picture here to share our ideas. First off, we said we have to take our brain out of the box, right? Thinking outside of the box in all aspects and putting everything on the table for possibilities of what we can do. Starts with high expectations. High expectations that we as adults have for the kids. Challenging where they're able to be challenged, pushing them beyond where they're currently performing. We said these arrows all lead to academic excellence. We looked at goal setting, not just us as collaborative teams of adults setting goals for our buildings and our students, but the students setting goals, short-term and long-term. It's something we've been working a lot with at Primary North this year, is making learning visible to our children, where they're charting their own progress towards their reading levels, towards their development, towards the math standards. We want them to be able to see their growth. We want the kids to take greater ownership over their learning. So when we talk about data, we talk about data not only with the staff, but also with our kids. We showed even the kindergartners, the first graders, here's where we're at currently in as a class on this MAP test. Here's where we should be and where we're going towards by the end of the year. So making learning visible for the kids, setting goals, and letting them set their own goals. Involving all stakeholders, informing parents, engaging with parents for them to understand what we're doing. What are the Ohio learning standards that we're working on? What is their students' progress toward that standard? Engaging, increasing involvement from all stakeholders. Mind shift. We look at the growth mindset. And how do we shift our mind as to what our kids are capable of and the mindset of the students that we can learn anything. And talking about agency, as Kenny said, and persistence, right? And seeking out a challenge. Those things that go along with the growth mindset. To really explicitly teach those things to our children. We looked at data-driven decisions. And then we talked about looking at specific data frequently to see how is each child at an individual level, how is each child progressing toward the learning target? Looking at individual students and looking at our data to make adjustments
in instruction. We talked about the school-wide learning outcomes, the New Tech Network pillars, the PBL processes, and really using those as a way of communicating in all of our different convenings. All the times, each time that we're together, to use those processes to have them become a part of our normal conversation with adults, with parents, and with students. And so we feel like with targeted instruction, looking at data points to help us make adjustments in instruction, setting goals, short-term and long-term, involving all stakeholders, taking our brain out of the box and saying, well, what's another way we might try this? We haven't before. And then making learning visible, where students are tracking their own growth, is going to get us to academic excellence. But it's all going to start with high expectations. Okay, so thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much. A couple of other tables hit the same issue. And thank
Here,
you for
I'll
your very
it.
Thorough job. Of those other tables, are there's lots of ways to interpret this. So can you, who's your poster child? You're still adding things, wow. Spokesperson, who's your spokesperson?
Courtney.
Courtney, can you stand up, please? Okay, and Courtney, 1 minute max, because we got a lot to hear from. Just hit the highlights, okay? Oh, Courtney, you need this.
We said everything Kevin Jones just said.
Oh, so sweet. Yes. And anybody else want to weigh in on academic excellence?
I think we do. We
Where
do.
Are you? Yeah. Okay, excuse me. Can you top that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Everything Courtney said.
Yes.
Alyssa had the most difficult time in the room trying to keep us on task because we were all over the place. But there are a couple of points that I think that came up in our discussion that really wasn't hit on. One of the things I think that we really tried to peel back was this whole idea of providing multiple opportunities for students, increasing learning experiences with students. We got into a discussion about just what makes schools seen as successful schools. And a lot of times it comes down to the opportunities that kids are providing. and in our reality, any kid that comes through the door, we're going to do our very best job with them. But the reality is, we have a mixed bag in terms of some of the experiences that our kids have. So in order for us to level the playing field, we spend a number of minutes talking about what does those opportunities look like to ensure that we level the playing field for our students. A couple of things that came to mind that are specific, the different experiences that we work very hard to give kids, like travel. When you think about kids having an opportunity to travel to Arkansas, our kids traveling to D.C., our kids traveling to China, our kids traveling to Spain, our kids traveling to Italy. The reality is, in some of these other schools where folks think it's the greatest place in the world, a lot of times they have the ability, their families have the ability to produce those opportunities for kids. In our reality, we're going to produce those opportunities for our kids to even the playing field. So we spend a little bit more time talking about what does the opportunity look like, and there's a lot more opportunities that go into play with that as well. We even talked about increasing the opportunity for connectivity in our community. When I say connectivity, we give every student here a Chromebook, but the reality is when they go home, every student don't have connectivity at home. So the school has a responsibility, so we extend learning hours to like 7 in the evening. We have partners like the Underground who give up an opportunity to send our kids over there after school for after school program where, guess what, they're connected to the internet. But how dynamic would it be for Forest Park to be a connected city? Green Hills to be a connected city? Springfield Township to be a connected township? So that wouldn't be an issue for the kids that we're providing this technology to. So there we go.
Great, thank you. So this is where academic excellence rolls into community connections. Okay, I am watching the clock. Great presentations, great thinking. But in the interest of trying to cover all the issues, what I'd like to do is move to the next one, which is community connections. We'll hear from one table, and then we'll move on and hit the next issue. And then we, if we have time, we'll come back to the second table.
Right behind you. Coming
you
at
guys want to duke it out?
No? Here you go. Have a...
All right.
Okay, so the first thing we focus on with community connections is how do we bring the community into our school? Because we feel like we're very disconnected to the people in our community, and we're heading in the right path right now with these back-to-school rallies, but we need to make them bigger. How do we do that? We ask ourselves, and we need to get better exposure. This could be social media. That was like the main one we hit. You know, Facebook and YouTube and all those other social medias, and even getting our school website out there. This brings more opportunities to advertise things that we are doing and things that we plan to do, and this overall brings more activities to our school. It overall just brings more people from the community and to be engaged. Another thing that you talked about is with the new school, having facilities that we could rent out. This could be a weight room, or if we have a swimming pool, rent that out, maybe the auditorium. But these things all make people in our community want to come back and want to be engaged. Another thing we talked about was making the school look welcoming. Nobody wants to come into a school that looks dark and dull. They want to go into a school that looks like a building they would... Yeah, exactly. They want to be welcomed into the building. We talked about some activities like these back-to-school rallies, cookouts, Zumba classes. I know we're doing that, but maybe keep them going instead of just doing it one time. But we need to be more exposed to the community and bring more people in with these activities. And I think once we get it started, it will keep rolling. And it'll be like a snowball effect almost. So one day we'll get to be connected to the community. We just need to keep heading in the same direction that we're going right now.
Right. Yeah. How'd he do, Josh? Was it okay to cede your time to him?
Yep, absolutely.
He did good, huh?
Killed it.
Yeah, okay. So we're going to jump to the NTN pillars, number N1, teaching that engages. Who would like to share your table thoughts? Okay. You have a poster child to go with you?
I am.
You are the poster child.
Oh, am I the speaker?
Well, then, oh, there you go, Emily. Thank you for volunteering her.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, can you come on over here and hold it up real big?
So we had Teaching That Engages, and to keep it brief, our big idea was to understand the process. What that means is you need to identify what your student needs, whether that be emotional or academic, before you start teaching them. I am. Thank you. So yeah, you need to understand what your child needs before you teach them. So are they hungry? Did they sleep last night? Do they have what they need? Like you said, do they have internet? Or is it just a bad attitude? Is it that they're transient and they're frustrated this is their fifth school? So you need to really understand what your child needs to teach them. And then from there, you need to understand what do they want to learn? How do they learn? And our overarching theme was identify their weakness and make it their strength.
All right. All right, excellent. All right, we've got one last question. It's N3, outcomes that matter. Who would like to share? Oh, over here. Oh.
I'll trade you, Frank.
Okay, you have a poster child and a spokesperson? Yes, you need this too. Sorry.
Many people would disagree, but. We felt like we cheated a little bit because we had a lot of staff members here, so we felt like we had a pretty good handle on what PBL looks like. But one of the biggest things we talked about is we talked about that idea of the ideal graduate. And what does that ideal graduate, what do we expect our students to walk out of this high school with? And we talked about, you know, back in the day that would have been something that kind of came down from above. These are the things you have to have. You know, our kids have transcripts. Every one of them will walk out here with a transcript with all the things Ohio and Winton would say you have to have. Students here, how many of you really are passionate about those things that are on your transcripts? You know that they matter because they're your ticket out. But our kids know that the outcomes they need are being able to speak to people. They're being able to be accountable and have a desire for what they know they need to do. Being able to walk into a class and work with any student in that class effectively. Being able to talk to their teacher and advocate for themselves. And even advocate to the principals when they don't like the way things work. Because they'll come to us and they'll advocate. Some of the students in here are some of the biggest advocates. They'll come in and say, I feel like this is not right. And this is what I think should happen. And as much some schools that, you know, you might have teachers and administrators that are like, you know, I don't want that for my kids because I want them to do what I want them to do. Our goal is to raise up our kids so that they know what outcomes they want. Because, like Kenny said, it's much more effective if the students are driving the learning. If they're telling the teacher, I need you to give me this, 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 and this. Now, the teacher wants those same things, and like Kenny said, they're going to kind of sway it to get the kids to know what it is that they need that has a shared goal. But it's all about that student voice. Now, one of the biggest concerns we have with that is, in a few years, we're going to have kids coming into the high school that have many, many years of PBL experience. And like Dr. Holden said, they're going to come in here, and they're going to teach us. What happens when we have a kid that moves in as a junior, and they were an AP student, wherever they were at, and they sat in rows, and they learned in rows, and they did homework and lectures and tests, and they walk into an AP class where they're building a catapult, and they got safety glasses on, and they're hammering on wood, and they're going, I don't know what happens here. Some of our outcomes that matter is we got to be able to teach every kid that walks in the door not only the content, but how to be the Winton Woods style student, how to do it the Winton Woods way. We have staff members that have went around the world in the last month to teach other places how to do it the Winton Woods way. We got to make sure that we understand how to teach our own students when they come into us, whenever they come to us, second semester, senior year sometimes, how to be a Winton Woods warrior. So that's part of the where we were in the outcomes that matter, how to make that learning authentic to all our students every day so that it matters.
All right. All right. Good stuff. All right, I'm watching the clock. We're going to get you out on time, but we're going to have you do one thing before you leave. So housekeeping on this. Be sure your work is on the table. Be sure it's got your table number on it, because we'll scoop it up when you leave. You need a table number here. And that will let us keep a very good record of what you have said. So while you were doing this activity, Jeff came around and very quietly put a pile of paper on your table upside down so you couldn't see what it was. So grab that pile of paper. It will say on it, beliefs. Can you find those?
Yep.
Every table should have enough questions for beliefs. Give a yell if you don't have it. All right, I take silence as, oh, you need one? Jeff? The whole table needs them. All right, so this is quiet reflection, and I'll read it in a second, but what I'd like you to do is, first of all, at the top, identify what your position is, student, parent, educator, etc. It is now about 11 of, we'll let you do this for like 4 or 5 minutes, and then I'll ask a couple people to volunteer what the difference between what they believed coming in here and what they believe now. So the two questions are, A, what did you believe about school before coming to this meeting? And B, what do you believe now? That's it. It's pretty simple. Go for it. Okay. So looking for volunteers who would like to share your personal thoughts. We only have time for a couple. And
hang on.
I would like the people who believe they have the biggest difference between what they thought coming in here and what they believe now. Does anybody kind of fess up and talk to the biggest difference between what you thought coming in here and what you think now? Did anybody have any big ahas? Oh, here you are. Sorry, I didn't see you. Could you stand up, please? Yeah, we really have a lot of rules here.
I just want to say that coming in, I pretty much had the mindset as a parent, a community person, and a teacher that sometimes we look at every child as fitting into a norm when they come. They fit into a norm when they come into the classroom, and after this, that's no longer the case. And as I told the group, the paradigm is shifting, and we have to be prepared. And on the flip side, I wrote that education will reach and meet the needs of many more students using this tool. All students can learn given the opportunity.
All right.
That's good. Here you go.
Okay, one more volunteer?
Sure, I'm close.
Okay.
When I walked in here, I thought students were afraid of public speaking. And what I observed were students that are articulate and comfortable speaking.
Yeah, yeah. All right, one more.
I'll go.
Oop. Okay.
What I believe that we have set up an educational framework that creates not only global citizens, but top-tier human beings when they leave here. And that is something that I believe walking in this door. What I believe now is that it doesn't take a school to do that, it takes a village to do that, and we have a lot of work to grow in creating that village and not just the school.
All right. Well, we're coming to the end of our evening, so thank you very much for all your time and your effort. This kind of night is kind of a little draining, so you guys have earned a nice break. Go and put your feet up. A couple things I want to mention to you. You all received a link via email to a website, right? And on that website, there's an opportunity to input obstacles to all this change, all this good stuff. So take advantage of that. We want to hear those. We don't want to be ignorant of those. Our next session is February the 21st. Same time, same place. It would be nice to have so many of you that we have to move to the cafeteria. Frank, do you think we can make that happen?
Well, let's find out. So we had the cafeteria queued up in case we had lots of people. This room served us well. What can we do to get more people here next time? What's the strategy? Any thoughts?
Communicate to our community.
How do we communicate?
Because I'm planning to talk to the people.
Well, you alone, we could put you on a pickup truck
Kathy's
and you could just
go
yell. Yeah.
Everyone.
Yeah.
That's right.
So, okay. So does that mean?
What's that?
Would that mean each person should call three different people?
No, each person should call five people. Okay. Look,
don't let go of the mic, Frank.
Each person should contact five people and ask them to contact five people. Because five people times five people is 25 times five more people. Because it's easy. Am I right, Paula? Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, another idea?
So another idea is to actually give parents a role. So maybe if each teacher could reach out to one parent in their classroom and give them a role, then it would be meaningful for them, and then it would be an outcome that matters, and then
great.
They may actually show up.
Wow, very good, very good. All right, we have...
And keep it very personal.
We have 35 seconds.
What?
Where
are you?
Oh. All right.
Yeah, you're cool.
Mr. Smith, anything to send us off with?
I'll be
yes. Don't send five, you come back also. All right, well, on behalf of all of us, thank you so much for coming. Have a great night. We'll see you on the 21st.
That means that I might be here, I might not.